الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين وكفى والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن سن سنته واهتدى بهديه إلى يوم الدين ما بعد. فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الذين يحبون أن تشيع الفاحشة في الذين آمنوا لهم عذاب أليم في الدنيا والآخرة والله يعلم وأنتم لا تعلمون. ولولا فضل الله عليكم ورحمته وأن الله رؤوف رحيم. صدق الله العظيم. My dear and respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for two reasons. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned both of these reasons in the Holy Quran. So, first reason for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this world was to receive the Quran. That Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the receiver of Quran from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam. And then the second reason for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that he should act upon the commandments of Quran, he should explain the meaning of Quran. So that people should know what exactly the ayat of Quran means. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in different places have mentioned and explained the same two reasons. For example, in one place Allah said, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. No doubt a divine light had come to you from Allah, which is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ, and an open book had come to you as well. So here the divine nur here means our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ means Al-Quran. In another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us that our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have said, لِيُبَيِّنَ لَكُمْ. That one of the reasons for which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had been sent is that he should explain the meaning of Quran. So now, my dear brothers and sisters, whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained, that is what Quran means. If a person is teaching you something contrary to what our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taught us, then we need not to listen to him and definitely not follow him. Why? Because if you are believing in the meaning of Quran different than what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam have explained, so this means that you are giving that person the status of nubuwwat, of Nabi. That you are telling him that, okay, what you are saying I'm going to follow, although your saying contradicts the saying of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but I would still follow you because your saying makes more sense to me, al-ayad billah, than the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in this way, what happened is that you are, al-ayad billah, rejecting the one of the main job of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that was that he was sent لِتُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, that he was supposed to explain the meaning of Quran, and then you are supposed to believe in him. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, as we are going very fast towards the day of judgment, one of the main issue that you and I are going to face is that people are going to come up with some weird explanation of Quran, and they will force their weird meaning of Quran upon people. And they will expect that people should believe in them. You see? So, and then, you know, people will become so foolish as well that they will reject all the ahadith of our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they will embrace this new meaning of the ayat of Quran, which are completely in contradiction to what our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. So our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam in hadith sharif said that a time is going to come when ittakhadun nas juhalan, that people will take illiterate people as scholars. Completely illiterate. Because don't look at the degrees that people have. You know, a person, you could be an illiterate person, but still you can have high degrees. You could be a foolish person, but still you can have degrees. You see? For example, if you go to certain universities where the professor of an Islamic studies, or a professor of Oriental studies, a professor of Middle Eastern studies, you know, he is teaching people and his students something which is against Quran, but he's a professor. He's renowned as a professor. He has several books. He had presented papers on several conferences, international conferences. So when you look at his resume, you will be saying, wow, look at him. This person, I think, knows what he's saying. But when you sit down and talk to him, and you try to learn from him the meaning of Quran, you will be shocked that this person's views are in contrast, complete contrast to what our Rasulullah has said. And then you will be scratching your head that how come this person is saying something which is against what Rasulullah said, but still people take him and consider him so highly. So we need to understand that, you know, you need to learn Quran and Hadith from people who are competent, not from people who are incompetent. People who know and who have learned Quran and Hadith the right way. Now, as in this Hadith Sharif, Rasulullah, I'm saying that اتخذوا الناس, people will take in ignorant people as their leaders. فيستفتون ويفتون. Now they will ask Islamic questions. Questions that have to relate to your belief and aqeedah to these ignorant people. And these ignorant people, you know, when they are asked questions from the audience, they are going to answer. Because brothers, you need to have guts to say, I do not know. You know, when you are standing in a gathering and somebody asks you a question, you need to have that iman, that strong faith to say, sorry, I do not know. You have to go and check with some other scholar, sorry, I do not know. For that, you need to have a strong iman. Most of us give some explanation. You see? There is a small incident happened many, many years in my country, India. It's kind of funny, but you can learn some lesson from that as well. The incident was that in a village where all the people were completely ignorant. There was no scholar of deen. So people got together and they said, you know what? We should send one of our youngsters to an Islamic seminary, Islamic school, in some other city, and at least he should come back and teach us Islam. So they picked one. And the villagers said that together we'll sponsor his tuition fees and all the expenses. So all these villagers who were ignorant, they pooled their money and they picked one person, youngster, and they sent him to another city that he should go and learn deen, Sharia. And they said that after 6-7 years when he'll come back, he's going to teach us our religion. Well, the thing was that they pooled their money, they sent him, but the person that they picked, you know, their choice was wrong. This youngster thought that, you know, I'm getting all the money for free. He went to the school, to the city. He went to the school. He did not like the idea of learning Sharia. Every month he was getting money from his village. But he was not going to school. 6 years, he did not go to school. Each year, he will write a letter to his villagers that today, the result of the first year came. And I passed with flying colors. Second year came, and second year, you know, like in our Islamic seminaries, in Sha'ban, before Ramadan is the final exam. He will say, well, this year I topped. Third year, in 6 years, he kept on lying. And he would never set his foot inside the Islamic seminary at Darul Uloom. So after 6 years, he came back. So the villagers gave him a big reception. The villagers came out to receive him, and he was given so much respect that among us nobody had become a scholar. This child is the first person to become a scholar. So he came, he enjoyed that attention, that respect. So as he was started living in his village, he started giving wrong fatwas to people. So in a neighboring village, there lived a scholar. When he heard that in this village, this is a young guy who claims to have studied, now he had come and he is giving weird fatwas and he is teaching weird things about Islam to the ignorant people of his village. So this scholar felt bad. He said, no, I need to go and see what's going on. So he traveled to this village and he talked to the youngster. What are you talking about? Where did you learn? Who taught you all this? This is rubbish. This is wrong. But this young man, when he saw that there's an opposition now, everybody is jahil here, everybody is ignorant, everybody is accepting. This village, this scholar has come from a neighboring village. He's challenging me. So he got upset. So now the scholar realized that something is fishy here. He talked to the villagers, and some villagers said that, let's see who is right, you or this youngster. So let's have an open debate, munazara, open debate. So now this youngster thought, open debate. If I will be brought in front of everybody, my secret would be exposed. People will now know that I'm ignorant and I wasted their money 6 years in that city. So what happened was that he had no other option. People forced him. So a stage was set. On one side of the stage, this youngster was sitting, on the other, this scholar was sitting. Now, then there was this moderator. So the moderator will ask a question to the scholar, and then the scholar will explain. And since he was a true scholar, he will explain the point thoroughly. When that question will be posed to the youngster, this ignorant person, he will say something in a very philosophical way. He said, what the scholar said could be right, but there is a difference of opinion among scholars. The ulama of Salaf, they have difference of opinion. So what he said could be right, and he could be wrong. There is this difference of opinion. So people will say, well, he knows more. He knows all the differences among scholars. Second question, third question, and to every question he will say there is ikhtilaf among scholars in this. Then the scholar knew that this guy is fooling everybody. He said, okay, I have one question to this youngster. Okay. And that question is that how many gods are there? So this youngster said there is ikhtilaf about this among scholars as well. Ikhtilaf among scholars as well. So he was exposed. So when he was a student back, my teacher used to tell us this and say that this is how ignorant people are fooling the Muslims. So this is what, brother, is happening. That if you take people who are not competent and they are you are asking them questions, and they are going to answer, and then they are going to, and then Rasulullah said that fayadillun wa yudillun, that they themselves are being misled and they are misleading others. Now this will happen very frequently, my dear brothers and sisters, and this will happen on a larger scale in the world, and this would be the sign of the day of judgment. Now the ayah that I recited to you in the beginning, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ أَن تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Nur, that those people who love, يُحِبُّون, those people who love, أَن تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةِ, that fuhsh things, immoral things, right, indecent things, should replace those things which are moral, those things which are decent. And this should happen in the Muslim society. So these people, when they see that Muslims, male and female, are decent people, the way they talk, the way they dress, the way they carry themselves in public, you know, they show that these people are decent, they have haya, they have modesty. So these people want Muslims to shed haya, shed modesty, and become immodest people, and become indecent people. So Allah says, يُحِبُّونَ تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةُ فِي الَّذِينَ آمُنُ. That's what they want to see among Muslims. لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Allah is saying that for such people who are trying to do this in the Muslim community, Allah is saying that I am going to do two things to them. And my dear brothers and sisters, this is something very important for you to understand, that there are many sins for which you are not going to be punished in this world. There are many sins for which you are not going to be punished in this world. Maybe yes, but most of the chances are that you will not be punished for that in this world. For example, a person is drinking liquor, a big sin. But you know what he is doing? He is hurting himself. He is not hurting others. You know, a person is not praying salah, he is hurting himself. He is not hurting others by not praying salah. He is not fasting, same thing. He is not going for hajj, he is hurting himself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in no place of Quran said that if you do not pray salah, I am going to punish you in this world. No. The punishment for not praying salah, drinking liquor and other sins is akhirah. Is in life after death. And that punishment is severe. Right? But there are some sins regarding which Quran says that if you do those sins, I am going to punish you first in this world. First in this world. And then definitely in Akhirah. Now those sins have to do with people. That because of you, people are getting disturbed. People either beliefs or people's actions are being affected. So if you do any of those deeds, Allah is saying, لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا الْآخِرَةِ. That for such people is terrible azab in this world first. Now, so in this surah Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that when those people who try to create immodesty, fush in the Muslim community, and they want that Muslims should become immodest people, and they are working towards it. So Allah is saying, لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا الْآخِرَةِ. For such people, first there is a terrible azab in this world. And then Allah said, there's terrible azab in Akhirah as well. And وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah knows everything, you do not know. So remember this ayah, and for two minutes I'll take you to another ayah. Regarding masajid. Brothers, when you come to the masjid, right? You are coming to the masjid because this is the house of whom, brothers? Allah, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when you come to the masjid, you should come with humility, not with takabbur. You are coming to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Rabbul Alameen. So you should be humble when you are in the masjid. The tone of your voice should be soft and low. And it is said in hadith, do not scream, do not shout, do not show anger when you are in the masjid. Why? Because it's the house of Allah, and there should be tranquility and peace and order in the masjid. But let's say somebody screams in the masjid. Let's say somebody comes and creates trouble in the masjid. Let's say somebody comes and creates enmity, hatred in the masjid. Somebody comes, you know, al-a'adhu billah, in so many places in the world, especially in North America, there are elections that are happened, that takes place. There are many political things that happen. And loving brothers who have been living together for years, they became hateful towards each other. They have now enmity, hatred. Why was he elected? Why? And that's all for what? For nothing. Literally for nothing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah told us not to do this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that masajid are the place where you should come to cleanse your heart. Masajid are the place where you should come to learn how to love and respect your Muslim brothers. Masajid are the place where you should come and and learn that even if somebody is instigating you, how to control your temper. So in Surah Baqarah, Allah said, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ مَنَعَ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ أَنْ يُذْكَرَ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ Then وَسَعَ فِي خَرَابِهَا وَسَعَ فِي خَرَابِهَا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, which sinner or which person, woman Aslam, which person could be a bigger sinner than that person whose actions stop people from coming to the masjid? You hurt him, you screamed somebody and he said, you know what, I'm not going to come. So they think that this person is the biggest sinner because mana'a masajid Allah an yuzkara fiha ismuh. And then wasa'a fi kharabiha. And not only that, but this person's actions are such that he is trying to create a rift within the community, within the masjid. When he comes, he just wants to play all kind of dirty games. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, وَلَعَيْكَ مَا كَانَ لَهُمْ أَن يَدْخُلُوهَا إِلَّا خَائِفِينَ They should have come to the masjid with humility. But look how they are coming and what they are doing inside the masjid. Then Allah said, لَهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا خِزِي Now brother, again, you did something that is causing trouble to people. So like saying, the punishment of this is that these people are going to be humiliated in this world first. Allah says, I'm not going to let them die till they face humiliation in this world. The same people are going to humiliate them. So, لَهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا خِزْ وَلَهُمْ فِي الْآخِرَةِ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ And then after their death in Akhirah, there is big adab for them. So any act that you do, in which people are being affected, Allah is saying, I'm going to give punishment of those actions in this world first. Why? Because this person's action had a negative effect on other people. Same way, my dear brothers and sisters, this ayah that I'm talking to you about, that tashi al-fahisha. Now, why I'm saying this, brothers? You know, my dear brothers and sisters, you know, Quran is clear. Ahadith are clear to understand. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, kitabun mubeen. Clear ayahs. In so many places, Allah said, tilka ayatul kitab al-mubeen. Kitab al-hakim. You know, clear ayahs. Easy to understand. But there are some people who are sick in their mentality. They want to bring such versions of Quran that would create immodesty in the community. So, the other day, I met a person said that one scholar, which I would never call him a scholar, but one scholar mentioned, and he said this very categorically, very forcefully, that there is no hadith, there's no Quranic ayah that makes hijab upon women mandatory. Hijab upon women mandatory. And he goes on to say there's no ayah of Quran. I was stunned. I thought that he's kidding. He said no. Then I went online and on YouTube I heard this person speaking against hijab for women. He says that there is no ayah of Quran that talks about the fact that Muslim women should do hijab. I was stunned. Because there are so many ayahs of Quran that talks about it. Clear ahadith. And we are not even going into ahadith. There are hundreds of ahadiths to that effect. And the ta'amul of 1400 years. From Sahaba to Tabi'in, Tabi'in, Tabi'in till our present day today. Now here stands a person, completely foolish person. But people are following him. And then he goes, that there is no hijab. I said, wow, how can he say that? How can he say that when in Surah Nur Allah very clearly said, Ya ayyuhan Nabi, O my Nabi, قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكْ وَبَنَاتِكْ وَنِسَائِلْ mu'mineen. O Muhammad sallam, instruct your wife, your daughters, and وَنِسَائِلْ mu'mineen, and women in general, Muslim women. That yudnina alayhinna min jalabi bihinna. That they should do hijab. Clear ayah. And I was stunned. That this person goes on. And then this person and his disciples, so to say, take on the social media network and they are propagating this. And ironically, people, Muslims like you, you know, nice-hearted people like you, you are becoming victim. Because that person says something which is although completely wrong, but he says it with so much conviction. I said, wow, how is this thing happening? And then that person is not only saying that, but he's also saying that there's no need for women even to cover their hair. There's no reason for women to even cover their hair. So he literally tells women not to cover their hair. Nothing. Of course, my dear brothers and sisters, those among us who are already not doing this, sisters who are not doing this, they are going to take this person as their hero. You know? But the thing is that not to follow a certain instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a commandment of Allah, that is one thing. That, you know, Allah have commanded us something, but we are not doing it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, right? But what is completely bizarre is that you do not accept the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have said this. You are negating, you are refusing. You are saying, no, there's no ayah in Quran like this. That is something, brother, this is big. This is tahrif al-Quran. And then as a result, the immodest actions, right, are spreading in the Muslim community. And when our sisters are shedding hijab, they are shedding haya, these people are happy that finally I have achieved what I have been trying to achieve. You see? These people are happy, and this is what in Nur Allah said, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ, they love to see Muslim women and Muslim men shedding morality, shedding modesty. And they are happy when they see that these women who used to do hijab, now they are not doing hijab, and they are happy with it. My dear brothers and sisters, this is exactly what I am trying to emphasize upon you. That you have to learn Quran the right way. Someone who is teaching you something contrary to what you have been hearing, what you have been believing, you know, you should check. You should counter check. You should go and make sure that what you are being told is right or wrong. Because the most precious thing that you have, my dear brothers and sisters, is what? Is your iman. And what does iman mean? Iman means Quran and Hadith. That is iman. You know, that is iman. So any kind of new things that people say that is contrary to our belief, you need to check. And my dear sisters who are listening to me upstairs, I humbly request all of you sisters, that any sister who comes and talks about hijab, that I have heard on YouTube this speaker saying this, you know, you have to come and check. You know, see how come this person is saying something which is not only in Quran, but it is a well-known fact. This is one of the features of Islamic teachings, that wherever true Muslims have lived, you know, they have spread modesty and haya. Wherever they have lived, even in US, you see that when a Muslim sister is dressed up properly, you know, she is going alone, she is not talking about hijab to or about Islam to nobody, but she is speaking a lot, because her dress is speaking a lot about Islam. You know, she is giving a dawah to other women and as well as men, that this is the way that Virgin Mary alayhi salatu wasalam, she used to dress up. This is the way the wives of Musa, the wife of Yahya, and all of these Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, their wives and daughters used to dress up. If you guys have left, I'm following. So this is a dawah, right? So, but then there are people who do not want these things to happen. But you will be, al-ayadu billah, very foolish, al-ayadu billah, if you accept such people's views and you go against what has been accepted by this ummah since 1400 years ago. So my dear brother and sister, again I would like to repeat myself. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have said in Quran, you and I need to believe in it. Every word of it. every word of it. And then the meaning of every ayah of Quran is told to us by none other than Rasulullah. The meaning that Rasulullah taught this ummah, that is the real meaning. That is the real meaning. Anybody who says contrary to what Rasulullah said, brother, throw that person's views away and embrace and hug and accept the views of our Rasulullah, because these are the days of fitna and fasad. These are the days of fitna and fasad. And the more we are going towards Qiyamah, the more and more fitnas will erupt. It's up to you and me to be strong on our belief. It's up to you and me to stand firmly upon our beliefs and let nobody hijack our beliefs. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help you and me understand this. Subhanallah, bihamdi, subhanakallah, bihamdi, ashhadu.